Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I would like to welcome you all and welcome the lecturer for this third session of the Gulf Studies Forum. The session will be entitled Educational Policies and the Products of Educational Policies, Impacts on Development and on Society in the Gulf States. The lecturers will be Dr. Kaltham al-Ghanim. The paper is entitled Does Education Empower Women in the Region? And we have also Dr. Ali Watfa, who will be talking about political activism of students at Kuwait University. And it will be a pleasure also to listen to Dr. Ali Fakhro, who will be talking about Gulf education and culture. To kickstart this session, we will be listening to Dr. Kaltham al-Ghanim, Professor of Sociology and Co-Director of the Humanities and Social Sciences Center at the Faculty of Arts and Sciences at Qatar University. She has published several research studies addressing family, women, and youth issues, and has participated in drafting a number of development policies and programs, serving also as a president or member of the board of directors in select development agencies. She holds a doctoral degree in sociology from the Faculty of Arts, Ain Shams University. The floor is yours, ma'am. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I will be talking about education and the empowerment of women, especially that our societies in this region have entered a new age, the age of human capital that needs to be available and show the potential that each individual got to contribute to the development process. There's a very ambitious strategy. And recently, women have become part of these strategies, and most of the development strategies in Gulf states have specific themes for women and empowering women through education and job opportunities. During my lecture, I will be presenting to which extent women are receiving education. Is this education is allowing women to access new areas and benefit from different aspects and the challenges that women face. Modernization era started from 1950 in the Gulf states, and a lot of things changed. Many socioeconomic changes occurred in the past six decades, and the change is tangible. We can see also a change at the level of the size of families. The extended family's role is decreasing, and there has been a shift of the power within the families. This reflects a social change that is occurring. However, I would like to shed light on the following question: to what extent this social change empowers women, or is it just a phenomenon that does not have any tangible repercussion on the role of the women in the society? Despite these phenomena, I have noticed several points that did not change or did not witness radical change, including the size of a family, because it still includes 6 to 7 persons, even if we can see a gradual decline in the fertility rates of women. However, big families are still the pattern. And this gradual decrease in fertility rates will affect the size of the family within 10 to 15 years. Statistics also indicate the continuous growth of the rate of families headed by women because of the higher number of divorces and the higher number of widows So we can see, according to the statistics in Qatar, the numbers jumped from 3% to 10%, which is actually very fast. There's also, regarding polygamy, there's a decline, a gradual decline, a minimal decline, actually. However, it's still not accepted. Or polygamy is still accepted. Especially for the elderly, however, when it comes to the young women, they are against polygamy. When it comes to education, many studies reflect that education is the vital factor when it comes to empowering women and the status of women within a certain society. Education increases the power of women. It allows them to participate in social activities and political activities. They become more and more independent and participate in the economies of the households. If we try to analyze these statistics, we notice that the illiteracy rate among female population living in Gulf states is less than 4%. And we can see higher numbers of higher education students that is exceeding the number of males. We can see here in this table the female higher education percentage, and you can see that in most Gulf countries, women are more than men in higher education, except for Oman, that is almost 50-50. The higher education is supposed to allow for women to have better status, better job opportunities, more improvement at the level of the social status, and a radical change. Some studies, actually there has been a very nice study that tackled several points and questions, raised several questions. Higher education has always been considered as the critical factor of change. However, we should re-examine this point because we need to ask ourselves, to what extent did higher education allow women to have a better self-esteem and achieve their objectives? There has been a lot of surveys. Our survey that I would like to mention in the UAE, women were asked about the gap, the gender gap, and their position vis-a-vis this gap. Women said that the gap is there, but they did not talk about inequality. They talked about the differences of rights between the rights of men and rights of women. So there's a specific understanding or a certain understanding. Women were raised to believe so. There's a qualitative or there is a difference about genders, and it's got nothing to do with inequality. So there's a gap that draws the attention regarding the perception of women, the self-perception. Of course, we cannot build all the information on one study. We hope that the future generations will study in the future this case in detail. We have also noticed that women's economic participation rate has shown a steady increase in the Gulf state. We're talking about the statistics of 2012. And since the 70s, there has been a gradual increase in the participation of women in the labor market. Saudi Arabia has the least percentage. And you can see the percentages of UAE, Qatar, Bahrain, Kuwait, and Oman. Here you can see in some countries, like in Qatar and UAE, like a third, or in Bahrain and UAE, like a third of the labor market is women. When it comes to the positions of leadership and the decision-making, we have a problematic issue. We have higher education students. We have more and more graduates. However, the leadership positions are still not there. In most Gulf countries, or actually in all Gulf countries. And this reflects that despite the higher education of women and despite the enrollment in universities, women are still not part of decision making. And this has got to do with who is in control of nominating and appointing people in positions of power within a certain society. So this is influencing the role of women. And if we analyze at the level of the sectors, the sectoral analysis, we can see that women take part in education and healthcare and administrative roles. However, when it comes to the high quality and influential positions like the political, like the judiciary, like the military, women are still not part of these sectors, even the industrial sector as well. They might be taking part in the activities of some companies. However, the positions filled by the women are usually administrative and mid-level positions when it comes to decision making within the institutions. And this reflects a gender gap when it comes to the distribution of decision making positions within the Gulf society. And if we analyze these figures, we can talk about the capacity of women of the Gulf to access the private sector or be like entrepreneurs within the private sector. Implicitly, we can talk about a huge participation of capital from women managing limited projects, usually from behind the curtains, just financing without being under the spotlight. We see that women have the liquidity that allows them to enter the private sector. However, there are several obstacles that prohibit women from or hinder the activities of women. Leading companies in the Gulf do not have representation of women within the higher positions, although women might have a lot of shares in these companies. Nevertheless, this has not been reflected at the level of the board of directors because of the social restrictions that prohibit women from practicing their rights. Although, as we have seen, most of them are educated, very well educated, and very well capable of having their own views regarding the direction of the company. So these obstacles hamper the activities of women. Although the laws do not prohibit women from owning or ownership. Therefore, not being part of the higher positions sets women apart from decision making when it comes to the economy of countries. As to women political participation, we can see that it is very minimal. In the UAE, we have 7 women out of 40 MPs. In Qatar, just 1 member of the municipal council. In Bahrain, 3 out of 40 MPs. In Kuwait, 2 out of 50 MPs. In Saudi Arabia, 30, but 30 appointed women and not elected women. So the political leadership in the region is trying to support women and remove the obstacles to empower women. However, we will see in a while there's a lot of challenges that have a different nature. In Oman, we have one out of 85 members of the Shura Council. So what's called the gender gap? This gender gap is actually reflected in some sectors. The participation of women in the labor market. Women have higher education, they have the best degrees and certificates. This is accessible. However, some sectors are still inaccessible for women. Society do not allow women to take part in these sectors. There are some success stories that media focuses on because the political regimes are trying to say that they support and empower women. However, in my opinion, the success stories are very limited and they are not up to the expectations and ambitions of the women that are educated, of course. Some people say education is the solution. However, education alone is not the solution. Of course, we need education. Education is necessary to raise awareness. However, we need something else that's got to do with the social structure, the cultural structure in this region. I will be showing some of the results of the study in order for you to get an overview on the challenges faced by women. The study that I have carried out is based on a critical issue, which is when individuals are active outside of the household and interact with each other, they interact with the woman based on the role of the woman within the family. The public is an expansion of the private. So women are always dealt with from the family perspective and the role of the woman within the family. This is the main issue that was suggested by this study. The Survey Research Institute, the Social and Economic Survey Research Institute, Sesri at Qatar University, we cooperated with them. We had a sampling from Qataris, male and female. Here you see the descriptive statistics. The sample consists of 1,010 Qatari citizens, 54% men, about 46% women. Women had higher educational attainment than men. Dr. Kaltham, you still have 5 minutes. I will be showing some of the results. The questions were regarding the decision maker. Who makes the decisions within the family, or who should make the decision? You can see that the respondents agree that there should be participation between men and women, but men support less this statement. You can see the results as well when it comes to the question, should women be free to work in gender-mixed workplaces? Males disagree more than women, and we have noticed that the young women are stricter when it comes to this question. I think the images need time to load. Let's move to the conclusions. Most of the respondents, for example, were asked about the preferred professions for women. They still prefer women to work in education. The question was, do you elect a woman or a man? The answers were, we prefer men. Do you prefer a woman or a man director or manager? Men were favored. And there was not a difference between the two genders in terms of supporting these questions, which shows that there's one culture, regardless of the gender, regarding the role of the women. One of the questions was, can the father or the brother prohibit women from getting married? Most of them agreed that yes, the brother and the father can refuse the marriage of the woman. And this shows that it is a problematic issue, the issue of the right of women. It's traditional, it's conventional, and it's linked with the society and the role of the women within households. Unfortunately, I couldn't show you the tables. I don't know what happened. However, the main issue is that the system that is actually available in the region distributes the role according to the gender, and the structure of relations and kinship identifies the role of people by their gender. The men represent the symbol of the tribe and the lineage. Women are identified as the wives of this man, and the relationship within a certain family is determined according to the biological identity. The position of men is higher than the position of women, and women accept that. They say that the head of the household, the identity of the household, is the man. This has resulted in relationships that give higher position to the men. And sometimes the equality that's mentioned in the Sharia is not respected within the family because of this mixture of what's cultural and what's structural. So I think these challenges we might be able to overcome these challenges gradually, although the study that I have carried out showed that there is not a big difference between the youth and the older generations when it comes to the relationship between the two genders. We're talking, of course, about rights and the distribution of powers and roles within the household, which reduces the role of education and the presumed role of education in terms of changing ideas and concepts regarding the distribution of rights between the genders and the relationship between family members. The family structure reflects or is reflected on the society in general. Within the family, there is no real partnership and gender equality, and this is what we see in the society as a whole. Women always follow men, despite the fact that they have higher education and they are skilled. Thank you.
I'm sorry for taking too much time. Thank you, Dr. Kaltham al-Ghanim. She has reached a conclusion that Arab women have good educational opportunities, but that's not translated into high leadership positions. This is a matter of dispute. Some people think that she holds very high positions at home, and that's enough. We will open this question and others to discussion later. I'm talking about myself here. Now we have Dr. Ali Watfa from the universities of Kuwait and Damascus. He is a member of the International Network for Human Rights. He holds a PhD from Cannes University in France. In the name of God, the most merciful, most compassionate, ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, first of all, please allow me to greet you all and welcome you all for taking the time and trouble to join us in this evening session. I would like to avail myself of this opportunity to express my gratitude to the organizing committee for their kind consideration and hospitality. And I would like to thank the University of Kuwait, which provided me with both moral and financial support for this research. I thank also Dr. Sadiq Al Ammari for chairing, moderating this session. The title of my presentation is The Political Activism of the Students of the University of Kuwait. And please allow me to deliver from the podium as I was advised by my colleague, Dr. Abdulaziz. And please accept my apologies. This is of a statistical nature, but I think I'll try and make it as exciting and less boring as possible. You can ask questions afterwards on the theme of political activism in Kuwait in general. As you may notice here that our theme is on political activism, the University of Kuwait, and this study emanates from a central question: what are the levels of political activism? What is its nature, its characteristics? This is not an academic problem in Kuwait. It's a political and social problem as a result of what student elections raise of issues and conflicts in Kuwait. And this research is based on 1,900 sample of representative sample. Before talking about the University of Kuwait and its political activities, we have to first say a few words about the Kuwaiti society and what kind of a relationship is there between the university and the society. What about the political nature of Kuwaiti society? For those who are not familiar with that, the Kuwaiti society is politicized, and it's like second nature to them, and this is a dominant factor in the life of Kuwaitis. And there is the famous Diwaniya or Majlis, which is an embodiment of a political and social platforms in the history of Kuwait. It's different than the normal Diwaniya or like the guest room in the house. And also, you know, the media in Kuwait has been strong and democratic and ability to influence events, not only in Kuwait, but the entire Arab region. The press in Kuwait plays an important role in society. Kuwait, as I know it, has a political elite since the 60s of last century, before independence, there are many political trends, and this elite has exercised huge influence in the political life of the country, and political life has been very active and noticeable. The Majlis al-Ummah, or the Council, the National Assembly, or the Parliament plays an important role, and there is always a conflict between it and the government, and this is a healthy sign that the political activity in Kuwait is very well and alive. The Kuwaiti constitution has distinct democratic features. Another important feature is elections. Kuwaitis have elections for everything. Even within their tribes, which are traditional entities, they are based on continuous elections. The students have their elections, parliament has elections, etc. So this kind of spirit is well known in society, and the University of Kuwait is no different to that. It reproduces this political reality. The political life at Kuwait University is a smaller picture, maybe even more beautiful than the country at large. There are strong relations between different trends, political trends. The university is very much politicized now, but since the beginning of the academic year until the end of the academic year, there is always political features appearing in every activity. Kuwait does not allow political parties authorized by the government, but political trends play a role, and they are sometimes even more active than proper political parties. So therefore, these trends are represented in Kuwait University, and it's a phenomena which warrants further studies. Political participation, which is very important, is a sociological term which represents the degree that any nation has gone or achieved in the field of political life. It's like blood circulation in the body and the democratic life. And therefore, it is normal to say that political participation is based on a value system. We cannot talk about political participation without such a system. And we can say political participation is as an expression of citizenship and democracy. What do you want to say in the context of political participation? Researchers rely on two concepts, the first being the elections, and political participation is measured by nominations and elections, and this is the narrower definition or concept. Today there is a more comprehensive, wider concept which reflects all activities with a political complexion, like taking part in general assemblies, societies, celebrations, elections. The problem this study tries to, I don't want to bore you with too much tedious details, but we can safely say that we live in this university, Dr. Abdulaziz. You know, as sociologists, we must be aware of this political participation. What type of participation is it? How does it manifest itself? These are the basic principles for more important questions. We took five questions, in fact. Number one is, what is the level of political participation of Kuwait University in view of student elections? Number two, what level of political participation is there in view of their political affiliations? Then number three, what to what extent is the political participation is a measure of political participation at large in the country? And also, will gender, the type of study or discipline studying or social factors, others play a role in this? The importance of this study comes from the importance of the university itself, especially that Kuwait University has not known such study before, and this study was conducted in 2014-2015, and it's a descriptive study, and we relied on different channels to gain information, like statistics, samples, questionnaires, etc. And the survey focuses on the indications and shedding light on the nature of political participation in the university. And it was subjected to all the methodological considerations. We chose a large sample, which reached 1,900 students. It's a representative sample. There are 15 faculties, and 9 for applied sciences, and the rest are for humanities, etc. You do not have to look at this slide with all the details, but the question is, we ask the questions, do you belong to any political affiliation or trend? Of course, there are the liberals, the Islamists, and others are there, but it's not publicly open, but it's noticeable through their activities. 14.6 said they belong to a political affiliation. And this is a very low percentage, because there are no political parties as such in the country. And we took elections to identify the nature of political participation. 44.10% is the nisbet of the turnout, which is good. It's about 57% goes to the males and 38% for the females, and it seems in Kuwait the males are more politically active. And the turnout in more important faculties, like schools of medicine or engineering, is higher. Some faculties have lower turnout. We asked the students, if you do not vote personally, do you support any trend or anything? And we saw that 90% of the students support one trend, 10% are neutral, 58.8% support the Islamist trend, 25% support the independence. So we can say at the political level that the University of Kuwait is Islamist, and it's feminist and humanitarian in prospects. 3.16 of the average is the or 63.2% is the level of participation. 72% take part in national events. 56% follow political events. And if we put participating in national events at the highest, you see that it has a good level of participation. On the question of gender, does gender play a role in the people, in the students' political participation? Yes, the answer is yes. The males have a higher rate of participation than the females. The social class of students, we ask the students, are you originally of Bedouin descent or like urban descent or rural areas or Bedouin nomad tribes? People, they do not mind. On the contrary, they are proud of their origins. Urban students say so, and Bedouins say so publicly. The students, they have their own perceptions, whether they consider their loyalties and allegiances go to the tribe or whatever. It is they who decide that. There are in some areas of Kuwait, all what you have to do is okay. If you go to any area, you will note from the name or the family name which tribe they belong to, and this is explains important sociological events. So for example, this kind of influence plays for as more beneficiary to Bedouins than urban students, because sometimes the slogans are of a Bedouin nature and they all come to the aid of their tribe and the nominee of their tribe. The other question on belonging to a political grouping or trend, because they are not they are not publicly announced and recognized, we notice that most students who say they belong to a political trend, have a political affiliation, where the ones who participate most. Because, of course, when they belong to a trend or a party or something, they ask to take part in elections. The discipline they study does not important, but first-year students, we found that participate more than the final-year students, and that is because first-year students are more susceptible to influence, to being influenced by political trends, and they are in more need of support, so they are attracted to certain affiliations until if they go further in their studies and become more independent. First-year students participate more than final-year students, as we said. Another variable here is the social one. For example, we notice that the area where the student comes from, for example, if a student comes from a tribal area and peripheral parts of the country, they participate more because of the tribal element. And also which faculty they study at, like for example medical students and the ones who study say in medical professions, they come from bourgeoisie higher classes of society, so they tend to participate more. What do you want to say? That I do not want to paint a rosy picture for you. The atmosphere at the university is loaded with elections, political, sometimes even violence among students, and so much so that the Minister of Higher Education is thinking of some drastic measures to deal with this situation, which sometimes manifests itself in tribal or sectarian manifestations. And sometimes, well, there is the opinion that the universities are places for academic activity and not political activity. Our conclusions that the political participation for students is average in comparison, and both males and females have a weak political participation. The males, however, have higher levels of participation. There is a place for social factors and other factors, and we suggest or propose that further studies should be conducted to establish why the female students are less inclined than the males, and to raise awareness amongst students to rid of the two factors, tribal and sectarian. Thank you very much, and sorry if I've taken too much of your time.
Thank you, Dr. Ali Watfa, for this paper. You have talked about the weak political participation, 50%, the very best or most optimistic estimates. We will be ending with Dr. Ali Fakhro. He is a member of the Board of Trustees of several Arab research institutions, including the Center for Arab Unity Studies and other centers. He has served as Bahrain's Minister of Health and Education Minister, and then as Bahrain's Ambassador to France. The floor is yours. Thank you. In the name of God, most gracious, most merciful, I prefer to be sitting here in order to be close to the microphone, because I do not like not to listen, and I do not like you not to be able to listen to me. So, and I don't want a computer to be separating between us. I want to establish this direct bond and contact between each other. I will be talking about Gulf education and culture. First of all, let us start by reiterating that there's a huge difference between craftsmen and educated person and the uneducated person when it comes to leadership, flexibility, human contact, and building relationships, etc. This morning I have talked about the United States of America, where they have discovered that the leadership of institutions, economic and financial institutions, of the graduate of the liberal education was better than the graduate of economics and management. Let me remind us all that the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, decided decades ago to make all the students who study there go through humanities, study human sciences, because the MIT discovered that the lack of knowledge at this level affects the future productivity of the students. And this is why the dean of the university said back then that the specialized engineer who is professional will work in a social system that has got its cultural values, and therefore this engineer will need to be acquainted with the specificities of the society in order to carry out his tasks in a humanitarian way, moral way, in harmony with the culture of the society. This is what I wanted to talk about. A lot has been written about doctors and physicians who do not have a background in human studies and human sciences, how would they be able actually to deal with people who are ill? The people who visit the doctors are influenced by the social, the cultural, the environmental, at the level of the family as well. All of these factors affect the people who are sick. So how could the physician treat the ill without being acquainted with these areas? So let us pose the question, which culture are we talking about? You all know that there's at least 100 definition of the culture, so we cannot delve into details. This is why I will choose what was said by Dr. Abdullah, the late Dr. Abdullah Abdul-Daim, in his book about culture. Quoting Dr. Abdullah, it is this flame that amazes and poses questions. And here I would like to highlight this issue and curiosity, because human beings are always curious. They want to know the unknown, and it perceives the society and the things in an innovative way. So the culture is therefore the capacity to innovate in the human life. However, I would like to highlight another point. Years ago, C.P. Snow has written something. Culture of the students, either literature or scientific, is wrong. Culture should be at the level of literature, arts, society, and also scientific, when it comes to biology, chemistry, physics, etc. And I think this is an important topic that will be tackled in a while. Why am I insisting on the importance of culture? Why does education have to be linked with culture? Because the objective is to help human beings to be objective, to be logical, to be independent when it comes to the character and personality, to be comprehensive and thinking at the macro level and not micro level, based on humanitarian and moral values, at the same time being committed toward the cause of the society and the values of the society. When I wanted to study about the Gulf, to carry out a study about the Gulf culture, please allow me to tell you, I do not believe in a Gulf culture. I believe in an Arab culture and not a Gulf culture. Why? First and foremost, we and the rest of the Arab world are unified by one language. So we have the same figure of speech, we have history, we have literature that is read in the same language and the same quality of thinking. We have unified history. The vast majority also is united by one religion, which is Islam. So I do not think that we can differentiate between the Arab culture and the Gulf culture. Actually, we cannot say that there is a Gulf culture. In addition to that, all cultural topics that are tackled all over the Arab world are present in the Gulf region. The heritage and modernization, science and religion, the mind and the practice, nationalism and pan-nationalism, Arabism and Islam, conventional, modern, reform, rebellion, or revolution, freedom or commitment, all of these cultural issues are tackled regardless of the geographic location of the person in the Arab world, and recently we have been talking also about the consumerism, which is the result of the globalization here and in other Arab world, parts of the Arab world. Despite that, I will attempt to say that in the Gulf, from the cultural perspective, we should give a priority to three cultures, three subcultures. The first one, challenge to carry out a religious Islamic reform. This is very important. We know that there are major weaknesses when it comes to the scholars of Islam. It is not accepted that a scholar who is respected and who has read the Quran 13 centuries ago and try to establish the rules when it comes to the relationship between human beings and families and households. It is not acceptable after these all these years and the all entire human experience to accept this explanation and not having our own explanation, our own modern explanation. We need to tackle this issue very genuinely and very transparently. We are not disrespecting, of course, the scholars of the past. On the contrary, they have done a lot of great things. However, in this modern era, we have to have our own studies. Personally, I have written in the past that there should be a new religious school. Some of you might disagree, of course, but in my opinion, this school would take the best of each religious school and add the latest discoveries in social sciences, political, humanitarian, environmental. That would be added, and that would be an added value to this new school. And this would reduce sectarianism and the belonging to different denominations. This might be a controversial issue, however, this is my own opinion. The second point is the challenge of cultural and political reform. Maybe we don't need to detail these things. For 1500 years, the scholars of the sultans reduced the importance of political thinking. They have focused on obedience, and they have focused on the need to follow the ruler, even if he makes mistakes. And this made the political life in the Arab world is the life of the strongest and not the democratic consultative life that accords a particular attention to human beings. Human beings were subordinates, have always been subordinates of a majority, whether it's a tribe, whether it's an army, a leader, etc. So the democratic culture that is not only at the political level, but even at the level of the household, the school, the university, and each social institution needs to be a high priority as a culture that is expanding and that is deepening in order to transform the people and the youth of this region into people believing in the values of this region and struggling to preserve these values. In this region, we have a social culture that has a lot of sub-belongings to the tribe, to the family, to the denomination, to the sect, to the race, whatever you want to call it, you can call it. And these are linked with the democratic culture, and we need to re-examine these belongings. It should be a priority to reduce these belongings, these sub-belongings. I think that since 40 years in this region, or 40 years ago in this region, these sub-belongings were way less than what we are witnessing today, and this is a huge disaster. So, this is the cultural landscape that I have laid out. What are the means that we can use in order to find solution to these cultural problems that we have tackled? Let me start by saying that finding the solution would be at the level of the house, the school, the university, the gym, the club, the theater, the mosque, the street. It's not only one sector. However, our topic here is the role of education in this regard. So I will be talking now about the critical sectors that would help building this new, renewed culture and civilization. Teachers are undoubtedly the key. You can give the best teacher the best curricula in the world, the best books in the world, the best environment in the world, but this bad teacher would provide you with bad results. And you can give a good teacher the worst curricula, the worst books, but this good teacher would transform what's good into something, what's bad into something good. So I think that the solution, particularly in this region that is a rich and wealthy region, is to focus on the profession of education. I have been writing a lot of studies about the professionalism of education. It should be a profession, a high-skilled profession, just like medicine, engineering, law, and I think the way forward is not difficult. The teacher needs to be prepared from 6 to 7 years, 2 out of them, as an intern, as a trainee, just like the physician who cannot practice and become a real physician unless they go through this vocational training or this the trainee phase. The teachers need to be educated, and here we are talking about the importance again of the culture, because the teacher needs to be a tool for change through the students, and this is when this teacher would be an assistant. He would help the students pose the right questions, revolt, say no, not only yes, doubt, ask questions. But the second point, we want to prepare or pave the way for democracy. School should be a democratic school. It shouldn't be controlled by the Ministry of Education, but it should be controlled by a council. We have an experience in Bahrain. We wanted a school not managed by a director or principal, but by a council that is headed by the director, the assistant director, or the deputy director. However, 50% of this council is formed by elected teachers, by their colleagues, because the teachers need to have their word heard when it comes to the direction of the school. This is how the students wouldn't be oppressed by the director or principal or the teacher. The student would be living in an atmosphere, in an environment of democracy, with suggestions, propositions, refusal, acceptance, and different interactions. And this is how we would succeed in building the concept of democracy within the school. The third point, we can talk about curricula and the knowledge. As you know, sometimes we have a lot of details in our curricula because the specialized people who prepare the curricula think, each one of them thinks that his field of specialty is more important than the others, and this is why they delve into details when it comes to all of the topics. However, I think that the curricula need to be linked with the human being. In what sense? The international BS curriculum has something that's called the knowledge module. It brings together different fields and it teaches students how to doubt, how to ask questions, how to acquire more knowledge. And I think this is key to our public and private schools. The second point is the separation between science and arts, or literature, sorry, science and literature. I am personally against it. This is why in Bahrain, in our high schools, the student needs to be prepared from here and there, according to his will. CP Snow said so. And even different organizations say so, because if we separate these two, the student of the science would not be aware about what's happening at the level of the society and at the level of the culture and history, etc. Should there be any separation, a unified curriculum is needed to include the humanitarian field and vice versa for the literature students. Here in the Arab world, actually, we lack enough of philosophy taught at the level of school. I'm not talking about the history of philosophy, but I'm talking about the methodology of philosophy, because philosophy can teach the students how to think, how to agree and disagree, and how to discuss. I would like to say once again that many of the problems faced by the human beings are complex. Let's talk about in the environment, for example. You cannot teach the environment without the environment being part of the economy and part of the daily practices, part of the extinct animal, desertification, deforestation. All of these sectors need to be tackled in a comprehensive package. There's a lot of intertwined topics that we can talk about. Very quickly, we can talk about a unified curriculum that focuses on culture. I will not be lengthy at this level. This curriculum needs to tackle human rights, citizenship, tolerance, issues of consumerism, and other topics that you are well aware of. Let's talk now about higher education. Here I would like to reiterate that most of the problems faced by the higher education are because of the intervention of the ministries of higher education and universities. In my opinion, the government has two tasks. First of all, enacting the law of education and higher education. And the second role is to include the Board of Trustees for each university as a necessity. And the Board of Trustees will be formed by the elite at the level of the culture and the education from the society. And this Board of Trustees should have the exclusive right to influence the policies of the university. Of course, the Board of Trustees puts together and develops the policies in close collaboration with the council of the university formed by the persons in charge and the teachers and the professors. Dr. Samia talked in the morning about education and the human sciences, and I agree 100%. The students of universities, should we want them to be educated, they need to be acquainted with social sciences and all of these sciences that fall in this field. We can also talk about finding a solution to the cultural problematic issue. For example, the issue we talked about, the religious scholars or democracy, and Dr. Ali also talked about the directions that are followed by students. The policy of university should boost the sense of responsibility. Of the student. The last point in my paper, because I'm running out of time. Mr. Chairman, you are very generous to me. Let's talk about the privatization of education. It's something that's also cultural. On day one, we have talked about the problem that the Arabic language is facing because of some educational institutions, private educational institutions. And during that session, I talked about the necessity of having any student graduating from a private school tested in Arabic in order for the countries to make sure that this child knows his language. The children need to understand their mother tongue, because if they don't, their relationship with their culture would be weak, ergo the relationship with the identity, hence the relationship with the nation, with the ummah, with the country, and this person would be marginalized, would be put outside, cast outside of the system that we're talking about. I have no problem with the private schools. Do not misunderstand me. The problem is about the ways that are used and how can we have restrictions and rules in order for these private schools not to be at the expense of the cases or the issues of the ummah, the nation, and the country. Mr. Chairman, let me conclude by saying that Konstantin Zurek, he's a great researcher that you all know, in 1931 raised this question. Whom of our young men and women can now, which means back then, clarify his opinion, his or her opinion regarding the universe and the purpose of life. He said that the knowledge of the youth is superficial and they lack wisdom, they lack literature. From the inside, it's like a huge desert and there's a poverty at the level of the soul. He used a harsh language, but imagine in 1931, he predicted that part of our educated youth will be in this position. Mr. Chairman, in countries where the history of culture has become tarnished with a lot of discrepancies, monitored, determined by leaderships and by despotic religious figures, It has lost throughout the ages and throughout the centuries its capacity to be renewed. And at the same time, in countries where the education is being taught in a way that does away with the spontaneous attitude of the student, it influences negatively influences the characters and personalities of the students. In these circumstances, we have two institutions that are failing: the education institution and the culture institution. Therefore, I sincerely hope that the two institutions work with each other and cooperate, one to strengthen education and the other to promote culture. Thank you, sir. I would like to thank you all for good listening. Thank you, Dr. Ali Fakhro, who posed or raised a lot of important issues. He does not believe in a Gulf culture, but rather an Arab culture. He asked for a new religious school. He talked about the importance of professional educators and teachers. And we will give the floor to the participants in order to raise specific and brief questions, because we are short on time. In the name of God, I have a generic question. Very honestly, since this is the... Please, could you get closer to the microphone? Is there a problem? I have something to say. I have witnessed throughout the sessions yesterday and today tackling education. I would like to tell you very honestly, we have shed light on every single negative point, and we said that the education system does not empower women, does not empower the good citizens, does not respond to the needs of the labor market. Dr. Ali also said about the lack of support for Arabic language, for identity. So what do we have left? This last session, let us say that the education system has passed away on the Gulf. Let us lay the foundation of a new education system. 30 and 40 years I have been following the strategies of developing education, the Arab strategy, and then the Islamic strategy, and then the plans and strategies that were elaborated by the Education Bureau in Riyadh and the GCC, in addition to local plans and strategies. And Dr. Ali was one influential figure in these strategies. Where are these strategies and plan, Dr. Ali? Where are we today? In the 21st century, we can talk about all these negative points. After 30 and 40 years of lecturing, of planifying or of planning, I am pessimistic, I am frustrated. I have just some questions regarding the research. As Dr. Ali, you began talking about or supporting what was said by Dr. Samia regarding focusing on the importance of human sciences, and this is something positive. However, the Arab strategies and plans included the importance of doing away with lectures and focusing or reducing the focus on these forms of teaching and focusing on the other fields as well, the science and the applied sciences. Some people, for example, consider that they only need to study law, they study engineering, and they study medicine. Dr. Ali talked about the political participation, 50%. I didn't see The percentage, yes, 50% of participation. This reflects actually political awareness. Dr. Ali, this is political awareness. This is actually a positive result of political awareness. So what is this awareness doing in these tribal societies? Why do we use it? The tribes win, whether we are talking about Jordan or Kuwait. So regardless of what we do, we will always find that the tribal issue is always key and at the heart of the discussions, with all due respect to the tribes. And Doctor, the results of your research are in contradiction with what was said by Dr. Yaqub and his study. He talked about the absence of historic knowledge and political knowledge, but now you talked about 50% of knowledge. I know that the constitutional and political awareness is very important to build this political awareness. So maybe we can bridge the gap between the two cultures. Dr. Kaltham is a dear sister, and I respect the research that she has carried out. While driving here, they were talking on the radio about the results of the Empowering Women Conference. Empowering women is happening, especially when it comes to leadership positions. We need to empower women, yes. However, there are other studies that link between the empowering of women and some bad results, like less women are getting married, more divorces, less women are raising the children. Some of them talked about the empowering of women being in contradiction with the bond between the mother and the children. So we should also take this into account. I think, with all due respect, that women in Qatar are having a leadership position. And the UAE, you talked about seven. However, you should remember that the speaker is a woman. So this reflects the role played by women in the UAE. So you said the leadership supports and education qualifies. Thank you.
Any more questions? Microphone, please. Dr. Abdelaziz Al-Mughis. My name is Dr. Sami Qustandil from the Ahli University in Bahrain. I talked this morning about ignoring humanity studies. I want to congratulate Dr. Ali Fakhro for his lecture, which provides a wonderful roadmap for reforming the educational system. And Dr. Abdelaziz seems to be rather depressed and at pains to explain certain things. We are here at a research forum. We are conducting critical thinking, and we should look at ourselves not with think with the spirit of sorrowful, painful view of events, but rather critically to understand. Look at our youth, our girls and boys. They neither speak Arabic properly nor English properly. They are moving towards radicalism. They are doing strange things. So viewing this and criticizing it and changing it is a healthy thing. The most important thing is we should not imitate the West. We imitated the West a lot. We took what this university did and what that university did. We got the syllabus from this university and that. We do not produce knowledge. We are people who do not produce knowledge. We have to produce something called knowledge, and this knowledge should be homegrown. It's not imported from the outside. and should be related to our reality, our history, our legacy. Look at Avicenna. One person on his own wrote the canon, the book of the canon in medicine. He didn't have any institutions behind him. Ibn Khaldun, another. What are we doing here, sitting just killing each other and talking about sectarianism? We are so backward now, it's unbelievable. Yes, there is defects in the educational system and pedagogical system. The vocationalism is not enough. It does not build minds, citizens. Thank you. One more small observation regarding the position of women. Is a man a question for me? I found what he said strange, that when women are empowered, people start talking about divorce. Nobody says that if the man is in a leadership position, he is divorced. Women work 10 times more than men. Nobody should speak on her behalf. We respect you. We no problems. As a mother, as sister, as a wife, as a colleague, as everything. These are the results of studies. I didn't get anything from Hatun Al-Fasi from Saudi Arabia. I teach at the University of Qatar. I wanted to repeat what Dr. Samia has said. Dr. Abdul, even if they are studies, we have to discuss these studies. We cannot just take them for granted. We should not hang the problem of divorce on women. This is a very wide-ranging subject. This is a controversial issue. So please, what is your point? What are you trying to say? Of course, my question is directed to Dr. Ali. I'm grateful I was here to listen to what he had to say. I share what Dr. Abdulaziz said, that Your Excellency were in charge, you were an official person. We are lucky to have someone like you who was speaking from a position of power and decision making regarding education. And all the ideas said are important and very fundamental. We want to know, when you were in charge of things, we were able to deliver these ideas. Thank you. Dr. Yaqub. Thank you, Yaqub Al-Kandri from Kuwait University. You really saved the best and last, and with all due respect to Dr. Kaltham and Dr. Ali Watfa and Dr. Ali Fakhro, I just want one intervention regarding what Dr. Ali Watfa has said. I agree with him 100% as regards the tribal affiliation raises the level of turnout and participation amongst those who descend from tribal origin. But there is another factor, in my opinion, which is no less important, that the members of the tribe or tribes, historically speaking, are more inclined to take part in political activity and participate more than urban people. This may sound strange to some, but if we go back to the history of tribal councils and how a chieftain is or a sheikh of a tribe is chosen, these are some sort of democratic manifestations. Maybe, therefore, they're more open to this kind of approach, and it's linked to the traditional values of tribes, maybe. In Kuwait, the first parliamentary elections were linked the chiefs of tribes used to nominate themselves, and they used to win because their tribes used to vote for them, and then they used to represent the political decision making. We hear the voices about separating political life from academic life at universities. I don't like politics, but I'm against that because universities teach people. Some voices are raised, but I don't think they are right. Thank you. Thank you very much. Now we will start giving time to each panelist to respond. We start Dr. Ali Fakhro first. Dr. Abdul Aziz's question, shall we announce the death of education? Dr. Abdul Aziz saying that everybody is mourning education. Should we announce the death of education and forget about it? Dr. Abdul Aziz, you know better than me. The question of reviving education or reforming education is first and foremost a political decision and has everything to do with political will. Educationalists, experts, can influence that undoubtedly, but the basic thing requires a political element. We, for some time now, have formed a committee to study certain proposals to effect radical changes in the educational system in the GCC. I was a member of that committee. Dr. Abdurrahman Al-Atiyah was the general secretary. We presented wonderful ideas. They were very modern, very human, very vital and vibrant. We sent it to the leaders of the GCC. They looked at that. They said, yes, this sounds wonderful. We refer it to specialized committees. Until today, the vast majority of our proposals have not been implemented. So therefore, it's a political thing. Now, when it comes to education, it's not a question which is debated in our part of the world. Go to Europe, go to Asia, go to the United States. You will find that the issue of education is raised. It's a hot issue. In every election, there's always a dispute and struggle as to how education should be conducted. In my opinion, if the world stops and refrains from building armies and insistence on building security apparatuses which oppress people, and stops from wasting time and about many things, you can give a thousand ridiculous thing like that, then we would have ended up with huge resources to be spent on education. We in Bahrain, I was minister for 13 years. We have done many reforms that the political leadership did not object to any. And before my days as minister, the Minister of Education was like Siberia. It's something, every teacher who was not accepted was sent to elementary schooling. We, with the American University, started with some reforms. I managed to get a grant from the government to send all elementary school or primary school teachers to send them to university where they spend 4 to 5 years being fully paid so that they become qualified teachers. And nobody said no to me. And this had a very positive effect. This was when I was minister. I don't know what happened after me. This created a new atmosphere altogether. Nobody objected to me. I think one person, only one lady, said to me, I'm 52 years of age. Do you want to send me back to university? I said to her, never mind, for your own good and your own sake, go. Before people, any graduates used to come to the Ministry of Education searching for a job, spend some time experimenting what he knows, and then leaves. But now we insisted on having an educationalist background. If you don't have that, it's too bad. And this was a very essential thing. The other point, when we came to the secondary school level, we said the students have mixed abilities and there is should be a minimum standard for hours and the maximum, and students should be separated accordingly. I'm sorry, I'm taking too much of your time. As part of that, we made the result of secondary school certificates to be a measure of the 3 years at secondary school level, and not just one final exam. Sometimes your father falls ill in the middle of the academic year and you end up getting bad remarks. So, and until today I meet students who thank me for that. I just wanted to say, why should we delve into so much details? I think, in my opinion, if a minister wanted to do something, he can. But provided that the political system should be aware and approving of that. Illiteracy in Bahrain was 25% when I became minister, and 13 years later we managed to lower it to 7.5%. But it reached 2.5% afterwards. Thank you, Dr. Ali Fakhro. Now we give the floor to Dr. Ali Watfa to respond to Dr. Abdul Aziz's question about the conclusions of your survey. My dear sir, belonging to a tribe is no tribalism, and belonging to a tribe today is not tribalism and does not necessarily mean a certain prejudice. The tribes now in the Gulf, because of the absence of political parties, they more or less represent a substitute for that. Now the tribes, before announcing their nominees, they meet and they elect a nominee who will be nominated at the national level. And this is the nature of our societies, Doctor. Secondly, this is umbilical research. We only saying that how many people responded and we took a representative sample. There's no contradiction between what I said and Dr. Kinderi. So Dr. Al-Kinderi took the knowledge side. I took the behavioral side, and we conducted the surveys from different departure points. As for Dr. Kinderi, this is a good addition what I showed you is just the conclusion. I did not give any explanations. Also, this tribal prejudice is a political activity in a sense, and what the reason why I said that is there are some tribal slogans, factionalism. Sometimes there was fights using knives and violence was used. And for this reason, some people called for putting an end to that. I agree with you, but the problem with the university is that there are some political factions who penetrated the university from the outside, and this is where the danger is. You have two minutes left. I only need a minute and a half. 2 minutes is too long. Now, education is being accused because of everything. Even Dr. Ali, although he was a minister, we cannot talk about developing society unless there is complete development at all levels, politically, economically, socially, and educationally. And whether you're talking about the Gulf or any other thing, the educational system is doing a wonderful job in protecting the status quo. And what Dr. Ali has said are good, but they are meaningless unless there is political will. Do you want from our political systems to turn our educational systems into a critically thinking systems, which will end up toppling the very same systems? Do you expect that? I bet you that I don't know, Dr. Ali has left the ministry, maybe because he wanted to introduce critical ways of thinking. Most people who wanted to create such a change, they ended up being changed themselves. Please understand that our educational system is wonderful. Yes, the minister who wants change gets changed himself. The gentleman is not using the mic, so we can't hear what he's saying. I'm a double agent. I am a moderator, a participant, and the editor of a newspaper. Dr. Kaltham, Dr. Abdulaziz, also has maybe a differing point of view, and we want a response to Dr. Sami, who said that on lack of education and other aspects. The basic issue here that we are dealing with and the issue at hand, why do we say there is failure when it comes to education system? I think there is failure. Failure in failing to lead social change, where the outputs are weak, productivity is very low, the outputs are not compatible to the needs of the job market. For this reason, we keep on relying on skills and experts from the outside. Also, there has been no cultural change until now. We have not changed our ideas about the tribe or like Dr. Ali's study. We have not changed our ideas about women and their participation or linking. I cannot agree with Dr. Abdulaziz that divorce rates are linked to empowering women. How can we explain that higher divorce rates than, or higher divorce rates amongst uneducated women? I don't think women are the cause of divorce, but the family gets subjected to pressures because of lack of compatibility between the two partners, and this is another problem we'll face in the future. that most married women are better educated than their husbands. So this will cause problems because they get higher wages or salaries. It's more, maybe women want to prove themselves more and the husbands will not allow it. So therefore, it's not just working women who are the cause of this phenomena, but we know that studies, when it comes to social issues, are somewhat targeted or directed towards certain outcomes. I cannot accept what Dr. Abdelaziz has said. Also, the fact that the speaker of the parliament in the UAE is a woman, there is a difference between women reaching high positions on an equal opportunity basis and relying on her own merits, and women being appointed to certain positions because the political leadership wants to portray women in a certain light. So why sometimes women are supported to pushed towards getting certain positions, whereas the rest of women do not get any opportunity? These are well-known exercises in political activity. Now, when we talk about unemployment in almost every GCC country, and I'm aware of statistics, there is more unemployment amongst women because society provides more opportunities to men than women. And women, when they want to find a job more suitable to her education, she will be subjected to pressures from the society, from even human resource departments. When a male and a female apply to the same job with same qualifications, they choose men over women. These are facts we cannot deny. So my question to Dr. Ali Watfa, that I find the students at Kuwait University vibrant politically. Why should it cause so much concern? There may be problems here and there because of certain affiliations, but the whole phenomena, if taken as a whole, as indicator that Kuwait University has better political activism than the rest of us. If we talk about prejudice amongst tribes to behave politically in a certain way, I blame the leadership. Feeling this kind of affiliation towards a tribe and allegiance towards the tribe means that there is a lack of appreciation of the general good, and the political system as a whole is responsible for that. I agree with Dr. Sami and Dr. Hatoum for what they said. Thank you, Dr. One final question. I'm sorry I didn't take it at the beginning.
Hi, thank you. Sorry, I'm going to be asking my question in English. This is for you, actually, so it'll just piggyback off what you were just talking about. I was glad in your presentation that you made the specific point that women and men share ideas of existing gender roles and gender norms. With that in mind, when we think about the word empowerment, there might be three components to that, okay? One is, I must recognize that I'm oppressed. The second point is, I must understand why am I oppressed. And then the third is, I know what actions to take, right? So it's a political consciousness and a political action. Based on that, based on your results in your survey, do you feel like Qatari women then can ever, like, is empowerment actually the right lens to understand this? Because if I'm not understanding I'm oppressed, my education is not going to help me move towards other, you know, gender roles. Just wanted you to comment on that. Thank you.
تفضلي دكتورة.
Speak in Arabic.
So she will be speaking in Arabic. Could you please? Here we can talk about the issue of education. Most of the members of that were responded to within the sample are educated. In Qatar, did this education create awareness when it comes to the role of the society of women within the society or the family? We find that awareness is still absent because women are still supporting issues that go against their own interests. So these gender disparities and gaps, women think that they are non-existent sometimes. So sometimes, for example, Qatari women think that they are not asked to have an independent character, personality, or independent opinion. And this is why she will end up electing from the tribe or from the family according to the instructions of the uncle, of the father, of the husband, in order to elect. And this is what the respondents actually said. Women will elect people chosen by the father or the brother or the uncle. So she has no independent opinion. She is always linked with the family, with the household. Education did not create this independent entity for Qatari women. Except for Bahrain and Kuwait, we can see some differences at this level. There's the figures reveal progress that's there. Maybe the older generation, the 60s and the 70s generation, were more enlightened than the girls, young girls of the 90s and today. Sometimes we see that the perception of the woman, the self-perception, was better in the past. In 1982, a study was carried out regarding the aspirations of the women in the Gulf, all over the Gulf. We noticed that the awareness was bigger back then. Now we're not talking about a generic study, but here we have samples taken from different countries. We see that the results have not improved. This is a problematic issue, and I don't think it's linked with women only, but also with men. Education could not create this force of change or force of awareness that allows the members of the society to become factors of change. They are reproducing the same cases, the same issues, the same things, and sometimes deteriorating. Thank you, Dr. Kaltham. Shukran, thank you, Dr. Ali Watfa. Thank you, Dr. Ali Fakhro. Thank you all.